So welcome to Jindal Global School of Government and Public Policy, and we are happy that you decided to join the course of BA Economics Honours offered by the school, and we look forward to a very fruitful relationship between you all on the one side and all the faculty members from JSGP. I am sure you have made a very conscious choice and an effective choice in joining the program offered by our school in economics. The reasons are manifold. You have got some idea in the commencement lecture just on the second yesterday. And I am sure you will be enjoying the discussions in the classroom and even outside the classrooms once we start the physical classroom classes. But even otherwise, when we are going through these pangs of having online classes, I am sure you will be able to interact with your faculty, with your peers over MS Teams, and never hesitate to get in touch with them if you have any problem in understanding some of the issues being discussed by them, or the most importantly, if you have any questions in your mind, because JSGP is obviously well known in terms of the fact that the faculty members are always open to questions from the students. And all of us believe that it is not just a process of the students learning from the faculty members, but we also believe that the faculty members have a lot of opportunity to learn out of the questions and issues raised by the students, either inside the classroom or outside. So please keep in mind that you can learn only when you start asking questions. If you don't ask questions, if you just accept whatever is being taught and you think you have realized and understood, then the learning will not be complete. For learning to be complete, you always have to raise questions and issues. That is number one. And the second point that I would like to remind you is that whatever we will be teaching inside the classrooms, be it on screen or online or offline, they will be mostly ideas and concepts and knowledge that we have gathered over the years. Not we means the faculty members, but what has been passed on to us by our predecessors. Your job also is, and that is how you are ready to ask questions, is to link them to whatever you are seeing around you. If you find that some ideas floated by your faculty members or by your classmates do not tally with your observation in the real life, immediately flag them and initiate a discussion on them. Otherwise, economics, or for that matter, any subject, any discipline, cannot be learned just through the lectures of the faculty member. That is why most of the lectures in JSGP are not monologues by the faculty. They are polylogues, I would say, where simultaneously, more than one participant in the lecture would get into questions, would get into raising debates, would get into discussions from their own experiences, and that's how the learning happens to be complete, not only for the students but also for the instructor. So these are two basic advices that I would like to give you right at the beginning, and never forget my advice, and you will see at the end of the day that they are very relevant and effective advices to be followed, because then only you will learn to ask questions. Forget your school days, where often, even when I was a student in class 11 or 12 or even in the up to class 10, we were rather indirectly made to believe that the teachers should not be asked questions. We should accept whatever they say, and we should follow those ideas, we should absorb those ideas and carry on. But we realized later that this sort of a belief is not good enough to help us really know and understand the nitty-gritty of the disciplines that we are in. So from now on, and then when we realized it, we found that, well, if you can engage in debate and discussions with your teachers, you are much better off. And we also found, when I became a teacher, that also makes the teacher better off. And I learned a lot of ideas. I gathered a lot of ideas from my students, which I shared with my next batches of students, and they also enjoyed them. So with this fundamental, I would say, advices, let us get into the issue that we are trying to discuss today. If you are asked to identify five big problems that we have been facing, not only in the country but all across the globe today, what will be your answer? You can raise your hand, or in case you do not, I will randomly pick. Okay, I already find two hands. What about you, Siddharth Bhattacharji?
Good morning, sir.
Name any one of them. I'll go in rounds and I'll pick up the issues from your friends as well. Well, Siddharth?
Sir, unemployment.
Unemployment. Very good. Navni Kanwar?
Good morning, sir. Sir, I think poverty is another one.
What are the five basic problems we are facing today?
Sir, poverty, unemployment.
Unemployment has already been picked up by Siddharth. You said poverty?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Then what about, I don't get your name, it's called VL.
Good morning, sir. It's Vedic.
Pardon?
Vedic.
Will you be a little bit louder?
Good morning, sir. Am I audible now?
Okay. Yes.
Yeah. I think one of the biggest problems in economics is scarcity of resources.
No, I'm not saying biggest problem in economics. I am saying, what is the biggest problem? What are the biggest problems?
In that case, I think scarcity of resources.
Scarcity of resources is a problem. Is the biggest problem? It has been for
the
years.
Biggest
it has been
problem.
There for decades. It has been there for centuries. It has been there for millennia.
I think it's the basic economic problem.
Okay. What about you, Vaidik Lapalikar?
Sir, I just answered.
Oh, you are. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. What about Linginani Varun?
Sir, global warming.
Global warming. Okay.
Intermediate practice.
Okay. Who is SS No, I want only one. SS. There are two SS. I don't know. Yes. Yes.
Good morning. One SS is me. It's Seher. So I think if we not specifically talk about economics, then one of the biggest problems would be climate change.
Climate change. It is already raised by Vaidik, I believe. Global warming and climate change, do you think they are different? Or you may say they are different, but aren't they linked?
I think global warming is a part of climate change.
Okay. Yeah. What about PS?
Sir, I think education, access to good quality education is a problem.
Okay. Pratush Swaminathan?
No, yes, sir. I was the PS. So, did you call someone else? Sorry.
Yes?
No, sir. I was the PS. I was the one who said the access to good quality education.
Oh, okay. Okay. So, that's fine. Yeah. Aheli Sarkar.
Access to good healthcare and such as vaccines and all.
Okay. So one
SS was me, Saloni. So my point is a lack of savings due to layoffs because of COVID. Okay. And even if people are employed, their savings are diminishing because their salaries have been decreased.
So, okay, thank you. So what I found that you none of you think, at least as of now, that COVID is a problem. One of you suggested that lack of savings due to COVID is a problem, but COVID is not a problem, is it?
No, sir, COVID is a problem, but the major issues that families are facing because of COVID is one of lack of savings, because of which education and health are indirectly getting impacted.
No, lack of savings, is it only due to COVID or there are some other reasons?
So presently, they are majorly due to COVID.
No, but is it so that lack of savings was not there before COVID came into the picture?
No, sir. But it's like according to the surveys and how people are reacting now, even good families from before have faced a lot of issues.
But there are surveys also which says that the higher income group has increased their level of savings because they cannot spend much.
Yes, sir.
Right?
Yes, sir.
So it is not that there is a huge lack of savings on the part of all the citizens of the country. There are some who are saving more. Those who are getting their salaries at the end of every day or those who are running their businesses, they are not suffering from this problem. Are they suffering? Hello?
So I would say that certain types of businesses have been impacted negatively, especially those that run in circumstances where large groupings of people are involved.
Okay. Now, the problem, the whatever problems you have identified, be it global warming, be it unemployment, be it poverty, be it health and education, be it COVID, and the related problems of savings. Do you all agree with me that they are problems faced by human beings only? The other living beings are mostly immune from these problems?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Maybe
I think someone for climate change, right?
Maybe in case of COVID, some of the animals are getting infected. Maybe global warming will affect some animals. But the rest of the issues that you have raised, they are unique problems faced by the human beings alone. Do you agree with me or not?
Agree.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Why?
Yes, sir.
Why?
Because animal needs are extremely limited in comparison to human beings. I mean, their two basic needs are sustenance and shelter, and they don't have to deal with a lot of the other stuff that humans have to deal with. So the needs are basically limited, and that's why the problems are also not as very diverse as for humans.
Very, very good, Anish. Thank you. You have hit the nail very well. If I ask you a silly question, that perhaps you will all agree, that other than human beings, no other animals study economics. Do you agree or not?
Yes.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Vaidik?
I agree too.
But the question is, if you agree, why is it that elephants do not study economics, or they don't have to study economics and face these economic problems that you have mentioned? I was expecting that you would be talking about some social and political problems as well, but you haven't raised them. But you have only raised some economic problems. But why is it that elephants or dogs or chimpanzees or even say mice and rats and rodents, they do not have to study economics, and simultaneously they do not face these problems that you identified as the main problems facing the world today? Yes, Ananna?
It's mainly because they have very limited needs and they do not need to focus on maximizing their behavior. So scarcity isn't a factor for them, since they have very basic needs and those are getting fulfilled by nature itself. In context, if we have human beings, we have very complex needs. So in order to get maximum satisfaction...
Why is it that our needs are complex? Very good. You have hit again the nail. But why our needs as human beings are complex? Would anyone like to answer? Yes, Vaishat Thakkar.
Yes, Vishwa, sir. So maybe because of their limited intellectual capacity, and that we are more evolved.
Okay, so this is what we have been taught in our schools and we believe in that. But do you think the intellectual abilities of the other living beings are zero?
No, sir. Definitely not. Because
do you think that they have no memory?
No, that is not true. We have to keep in mind that they've evolved according to their environment. So, for instance, if we look at octopi and other cephalopods, they have evolved certain abilities, I would say. They can mimic other creatures. They can change the skin tones. So I would say that's a fairly good evolution, but it depends on the environment. So the notion that they aren't evolved or less evolved is false, according to me.
Sir, I would say that we have greater needs because we no longer live in a do or die situation like animals, where they are either hunted or they have to escape being hunted. We live safer, more secure lives, and thus we can look for things that are greater than just a place to live and just food to eat.
Okay, very good. Now, it is said that economics is required to be studied because of two features of human beings, vis-a-vis the earth or vis-a-vis the planet. Number one, resources are scarce. And secondly, our wants are unlimited, right? Siddharth?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes.
What is the implication? Suppose any one of these two ideas is dropped and we keep only one. We say that resources are scarce, but ones are limited. Will there be a subject called economics?
No, sir, because aspect of maximizing everyone's
Suppose all the human beings are saints and sages, right? They consume only as much as they require to sustain. Will there be a reason behind the emergence of a subject called economics?
No, sir. I think there will be. Yes, sir.
Why? Those who are because
human wants the different priorities.
No, I am saying the basic requirements for livelihood. If human beings leave their wants up to that, will there be a subject called economics?
Then it will not exist.
Yes, sir. I think there will be, because there also needs to be the problem that needs to be sorted, that there needs to be allocation of resources so that we have maximum satisfaction.
No. The point is, if we are happy with some limited availability of resources, will there be a need for maximization of satisfaction?
No, satisfaction becomes irrelevant. Satisfaction becomes irrelevant.
Then satisfaction becomes irrelevant because we are happy with whatever is available. So do you think the early human beings had economics?
No, sir.
No.
No, sir.
So the point is, on the other hand, consider the other way around, that human wants are unlimited, but the resources are also unlimited, as it is in heaven. Was there a need for economics?
No.
No, sir.
No, sir.
So economics is necessary to be studied because of simultaneous operation of two characteristics. Number one, the resources are to be limited. If resources are unlimited, there was no need for economics. There is no need for studying a subject which will help you to understand as to how we so-called optimize our objectives. Right? Because whatever you want, you get it. So economics would not have been relevant had resources not been scarce. But economics also would not have been relevant if we had limited wants. Suppose of a sage or a saint who goes to the Himalayas and meditate. Does he have to care about economics and the ideas that you raised, poverty, unemployment, savings, and all these issues?
No, sir.
So always when you start studying economics, keep in mind that this subject is to be taught because of the interaction between these two basic issues, that we are not happy with what we get, and number one, and number two, the resources that are available are not plentiful, are not abundant, and that is why we study economics. Till a few days back, maybe 20 years back, of course, you were not born, but in the world, at least in India, there was no concept of bottled water being sold. Right? Hello?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
What was the reason?
Because water was...
Because there was no scarcity of water. There was no scarcity of water. And as a result, there was no economics of water. Isn't it, Siddharth?
Yes, sir.
There was no economics of masks in India, neither before COVID, or even if you go back a little, even in a situation not without COVID, you could see people wearing masks. Why were they wearing masks that time?
That was due to air pollution.
Due to air pollution.
As long as the air was pure and without any pollution, was there any demand for masks?
No, sir.
Why? Because pure air was available without any scarcity, and as a result, there was no demand for masks. And if there is no demand for masks, there is no economics of masks. Right?
Yes, sir.
Yes, yes, sir.
So the point is, let us try to understand why the animals do not have economics then. The plants do not have economics. Can you come to the answer now?
Because animals, in comparison to their wants, their resources, their wants are quite limited and their resources are quite abundant.
That may not be, because maybe the resources have been usurped by human beings, right?
Yeah.
Isn't it?
Yes, sir, yes.
But their wants are limited. What is the indication that our wants as human beings are unlimited? The indications are
that we are
not happy with whatever we get from nature. We convert some of the resources we get from nature into something else, which the nature cannot provide us with. Take the case of a car, take the case of good food, or take the case of dresses. These are some of the resources, some of the products, which the other living beings do not consume, right? Pratush?
Yes, so.
Yes, Professor.
Ananna?
Yes, sir.
So what we do? We transform some resources into something else, which the nature cannot provide us with directly. There is no tree found in the world where you find the cars hanging from. Had it been hanging from a tree, we would have said that it is a gift, or it has been given to us by nature. So even you won't find a tree from where you find packets of biryani or parathas hanging. Right? So the fundamental point that you have to realize is that human beings are not happy with what they get directly from nature, and they have become innovative, they have become inquisitive, and through this innovativeness and inquisitiveness, they have come out with some resources which are not available from nature, and which are called, according to economics, which are called produced resources. Right, Shahar?
Yes, sir.
So what does that mean? Can we say, as long as we study economics, can we say the fundamental difference between human beings and other living beings runs in terms of the fact that unlike other human beings, unlike the other living beings, human beings have unlimited wants, and to meet their unlimited wants, they have started an activity which is not prevalent among the other living beings. That is what we call, quote unquote, production. Can we make this statement, Saloni? Are you there, Saloni? Vishwa Thakkar?
Yes, sir.
So always keep in mind, as long as you will be studying economics, that we are different from the rest of the living beings because we produce. And produce means we convert some natural resources, some resources available from nature, into something else which nature cannot provide us. And why we do it? Because we have unlimited demands. We want more and more. And we have used our capacity to discover and invent the idea of production. And in the process of the production, gradually now we have realized that we have engaged in an activity which also creates something which we are also not ready to consume. Aheli, is there anything that we produce which we want to, do not want to consume, but they have been produced because we wanted to consume something else? Right, Aheli?
Yes,
what are they?
Waste, that is generated.
What are they?
Waste. That is,
they are the pollution. They are the pollution.
Yes.
So what are pollutions? Pollutions are those which we have produced, but we refuse to consume. I am not getting many of the names here. Let me just invite Tejas Khemka.
Hello.
Huh? Can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you.
So, what is your idea of pollution? Is it something that we produce but we don't want to consume?
Sir, it is, yeah, maybe it is something we produce but we don't want to consume, like.
And what we do with them? Since we produced it, but we don't want to consume, we dump them onto the nature.
Yeah, we dispose it to the nature, yes.
Okay. And now what is the problem with nature? Nature did not produce it.
It goes beyond the absorbing capacity of the nature.
Exactly. So when we are produced, and mind you, that we started production, and then gradually it so happened that we simultaneously started production of goods that we want to consume and goods that we don't want to consume. And we consumed the goods that we wanted and dumped those which we produced but did not want to consume into the nature. And what happens to nature now? since nature did not produce them, nature also does not have a mechanism to absorb them to the extent that we are producing them. And that is why we have come across two types of pollutions. One is called biodegradable pollution, and another is called non-degradable pollution. Right, Vaidik?
Absolutely.
What is the non-biodegradable pollution? They are the ones which the nature cannot absorb.
Yep.
And in case of biodegradable pollution, if the if their production increases at a rapid rate, then also nature faces a problem to absorb them within a very short period of time. Right, Saloni?
Sir, actually, Saloni is facing some connectivity issues.
Right? Okay. So let me go for another name, Ishita Watts.
Yes, sir.
Do you agree with me or not? I asked a question. Did you hear that or not? Okay. You were sleeping, it seems. Anyway, so what about Samarth Anand?
Yes, sir. I agree with you.
Okay. So it's a very safe answer. Even if you haven't listened to what I said, this answer makes sense. Would you like to elaborate a little, Samarth? Because you are Samarth by your name, right?
Yes, sir.
Huh? You know the meaning of Samarth, right?
Yes, sir.
So what is your, how you prove that you are Samarth to answer my question? Would you like to elaborate a little?
Okay, sir. So you said that due to a lot of production and, unlimited wants, we want to produce more, and due to that pollution is happening, which is a byproduct of that and which is non-biodegradable. Yes, pollution is non-biodegradable, obviously, and it causes a lot of problems.
Even our unlimited wants has created a situation where we are producing unlimited, even biodegradable pollution, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
And this unlimited biodegradable pollution is also a problem with nature, because it had its own capacity to absorb some of the biodegradable pollutions.
Yes, sir.
And that is why, as human civilization progressed, we have come to a situation where the unlimited wants of human beings are accompanied by unlimited creation of pollutants and their dumping into the nature. Navni? Navni? Are you there?
Yes, sir.
So
Is it
clear, or you have any question?
No, so it's clear.
Okay. But I told you that you should always raise questions. That is what you have to learn right from the first day. Now, take the point. So, in our quest for unlimited wants, and in our quest for, someone said right at the beginning, our quest for maximization of satisfaction or optimization of satisfaction, Do you agree with me if I make a statement that we are moving towards an optimal degradation of nature?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Tejas?
Sir, in what sense do you mean optimal degradation of nature?
This is what we are doing. If you dump pollutants into the nature, are we degrading nature or not?
We are. That is true. But what about the efforts that are being made? What about the efforts that are being made to conserve resources and limit the amount of pollution we create? Would that not have an impact on degradation? Would it not slow that process down?
I just could not get your point. Can you repeat it once again? Even if what?
So what I'm trying to ask is that since we are getting more educated about the negative effects human activity has on the environment, as you say, pollution, efforts being made to conserve resources and limit the amount of pollutants we release,
right,
should they not have a slowing down process on degradation?
Yes, that is exactly the point that I am coming to. The moment you want to go against the optimization of natural degradation, what are you doing?
You are
going to a process of quote unquote not optimizing your satisfaction in an unrestricted manner, isn't it?
Yeah, makes sense.
You are putting restrictions on your behavior, right?
True.
So whatever optimization you achieved earlier, your level of optimization will now be less. Vaidik?
Yes, sir, I agree.
So what does that mean? That we are gradually realizing that there is a necessity to balance between optimization of human satisfaction and optimization of natural degradation. Do I make sense or not?
Yes, that makes sense to me.
So if we want to optimize, we cannot optimize to the capacity that we have right now, because the capacity of optimization is creating problem for nature, and that in the longer run will reduce our optimization level in the future. And that is why we are trying to put some brakes on our unlimited wants and see that we do not want something which will jeopardize the existence of nature as such. Vaidik?
Yes, sir, I understood.
And that is what is now called the social ecological system. So far, in economic theory and economic concepts, till the last 50 years, we were not concerned about the linkage between economics and nature directly. Can you say how economics considered natural resources or the planet? Yeah, well, did it consider ever the way the fundamentals of economics that we have learned so far, how was nature considered as a component of our unlimited wants? Let me go to some other names. I find a thinker in Anjali. Her photograph at least says that, well, she is a great thinker. Right, Anjali? Are you there? No, she is not there. She is thinking. What about Mithil Agarwal? So who is there who has raised his hand? I cannot. Can you just come up?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Sir, land is an important, nature is an important part in the economics field. Because, sir, we just studied that we have unlimited wants for humans. And we have lots of, demands are more. And so, sir, nature provides us with resources which are used in the production processes, sir. Such as land and other resources.
But was nature considered a part of our production process in economics, in the conceptualization of economics?
Yes, sir. Yes,
how did we incorporate nature as a part of the production process?
So basically, it's included in the main three processes, land, labor, capital, sir. So because land is the fundamental part in which we set up the company or the setup of production processes, sir.
What is land?
Sir, land is a gift from the nature, sir, in which sir, it's a free resource which the human doesn't have to pay and it's directly available.
Absolutely. Very good. Who is it?
Sir, Parth Sharma, sir.
Okay, very good. So it what I find through your through interactions with you, that perhaps our faculty members will not have to work very hard to help you understand economics, and you can also contribute to their understanding of economics as well. Thank you, Parth. So the point that has come very clearly, that when we developed when the theory of economics were developed, we identified it from the perspective of production to be composed of four factors of production: land, labor, capital, and organization. And land is what? Land is what is available directly from nature as a free gift. If later we were made to pay for land from some resources of nature, we did not pay it back to the nature. We paid it to the owner of the land resources who grabbed it. Right, Parth?
Yes, sir.
If someone has grabbed some land, if someone has grabbed some water source, we paid it to the owner of that piece of land or a piece of the water source, but we did not pay it back to nature, did we?
No, sir, we just violated the nature, sir, because now the trees are being cut and it's hurting the mother nature.
Yes. Now, when we are talking about sustainable development, what are we talking about? We are also talking about that, well, we are taking resources from nature and we have to pay the nature back for taking those resources, isn't it, Vaidik?
Yes, yes.
So do you now get the fundamental point that when we'll be studying economics today, we also have to consider an important perspective of production, that we have to pay back to nature for the resources we consume from her. Not directly for the resources, but indirectly for the resources in terms of pollutants that we give back to nature. Tejas?
Yes, sir.
So now the realization has dawned in that economics cannot be studied where we take nature for granted. And economic problems, as now, can you link all those problems that you mentioned at the beginning to the fact that as economists, for a long, long time, we disregarded this linkage between our production process and the degradation of nature? Do you now agree with me, or do you Have you been able to get that idea? Please raise your hand. You don't have to say anything if in case you have understood. No one? Okay. So now economics has become a science or a subject which will now try to understand optimization of human satisfaction, but subject to lesser degradation of nature, which was not there 50 years from now. And that has led us to think in terms of the social ecological system, where we have found that human beings are no longer separated from nature. For about 200 years, 300 years since the beginning of the Industrial Revolution, almost 300 years, before that, there was an idea that, well, we are also a part of nature and we have to live in harmony with nature. With new innovations, with Industrial Revolution, we started believing that, well, we are not under the control of nature, but we have come to a level of cognition and intellect and understanding where we are capable of controlling nature. And this arrogance, I would say, if you don't mind, this arrogance of human knowledge, human understanding, led us to a situation of global warming and climate change, and maybe even the pandemic of COVID. Right? Would anyone like to, Ananna?
Yes, sir.
So the situation that we have come today makes us realize that, well, we committed a lot of mistakes by not considering land as an important factor of production. Because if you have studied the production process, production functions, you will always find that we talk in terms of land and capital, as if the other two are always given. Right, Vaidik?
Yes.
What does it mean? That it means that we took nature for granted, that, well, whatever. And what is capital? What is the definition of capital?
Capital is the man-made thing, means of production, such as the machines and the money we spend in the production processes.
So what does that mean?
So it's
capital is all that is not given by nature, but yes, what we produce man-made. Ourselves. Man-made. Right? Hello? Vaidik? Yes, someone else was speaking. Who was it?
Sapad.
Please. Some girl was speaking out.
Sir, am I audible now? I had connection issues before. Saloni. Sir, Saloni, I had connection issues before.
Okay. Very good. So now you have, you don't have to use the natural resources to talk to me. You can use the capital, right? Hello?
Yes.
Because the fact that you are speaking to me, where from are you speaking out? Where are you
located? Actually, I'm somewhere near Kargil. That's why I'm having issues here.
Somewhere near?
Kargil, sir.
Oh. Now, had there been no produced technology, would you have been able to talk to me from Kargil, and I am located in Greater Noida near Delhi? Would you have been able to do that?
No, sir.
So, man was ingenuine. Or men and women as well. I am not going to any gender discrimination. But human beings were ingenuine in creating capital. Capital is something which is not available from nature. So, Samarth, do you know understand that when we developed the economic as a subject for the last 200, 300 years, we developed it from a perspective as if the free gifts of nature are available and they can be used to generate capital. And the more capital we gather, the more capital we amass, the more productive capacity we generate, and to meet our quote-unquote unlimited wants, even though resources are scarce.
Yes, sir. I agree that we used to, produce blindly without thinking about the results of the production which we will have on nature. For example, the statement that supply will create its own demand, it itself proves that we used to just blindly, manufacture goods and not think about the effect it would have on the environment. And so, yeah.
Very good. Very good. You have proved your name to be correct, right?
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Right? So that's the point. So now, if we have to study economics, we have to also consider the impact of our economic decisions on nature. And if we disregard that, we'll face problems of excessive rains, problems of drought, problems of even COVID. Because what happened to COVID? Why? There are two theories. One theory is that it leaked from a lab, right? Even if that is true, then what does it mean? That we tried to produce some virus that was not available from nature, right? Tejas?
Yes, sir.
Or there is another idea that it spread from another animal into human beings. What does that mean? Why a virus located in the body of one animal did transmit into human beings? Because we have destroyed the habitats of those wild animals and we have come closer to them, right?
Yes, sir.
Vaidik or anyone else?
Yes, sir, that would be true.
Yes. So whatever way you look at, we either produced this virus or we came in closer contact to this virus because we have destroyed the habitat of these animals which were harboring this virus. Right? So the point that I wanted to make here is that now economics cannot afford to be independent of the ecological and environmental concerns that are the result of our unlimited quest for more goods and more commodities and more services. And that is why economics should not just be considered as an independent standalone discipline, but it should also be considered as a part of a broader system that understands the linkage between nature and those who produce. Do I make sense or not?
Yes.
Yes, sir.
So in the process, I have overshot the time allotted to us. I would like to stop here. If you have any observation or question or any issue to raise, you are welcome. Please raise your hand first and then I'll invite you. Or if you don't have, then let me thank you. So which option do you choose? The first one or the second one? Tejas? D. Yes, sir, there was some hands raised. Yes, please.
Sir, could you repeat the two options again?
Pardon?
Sir, what was your question? You could repeat that.
No, the question was either we can say goodbye. That is the first, second, in fact, earlier it was the second option. Or you can raise questions. That is the first option. So which option do you choose? Okay, that means we choose the second option. Bye bye. Thank you.
Sir, I have a question.
Then why are you so late? Yes. Who is this? Ananya.
Sir, if we say that production will all, it leads to degradation, can there ever be production which will not cause any harm to nature?
Yes. That is why we are saying that our unlimited wants have to be constrained unlimited wants.
And how will that happen?
It will, you have to depend on the capacity of nature. Right?
Yes.
You can reduce the pollution, you can reduce the degradation of nature. You may not bring it to zero, but you can, you have to do it. You bring it down to a lower level if you want to enjoy your unlimited wants.
But in order to do this, many people have to be educated about how, what activities are impacting the environment.
Do you think the educated people do not pollute, or do you think uneducated people pollute more?
They both contribute equally. I think so.
Who pollute more?
Educated people.
Yes. So our definition of education, maybe also if you, I agree to your point, our definition of education has also to change, right?
Yes.
But thank you very much for raising this point.
Sir, I have a question.
Yes, please. Who is it?
Siddharth.
Okay.
So, sir, do you think that developed countries which are more industrialized and have taken more from nature have a greater responsibility to give back as well as compared to, say, a country like India, which is not as industrialized and has not taken much from nature?
There is no doubt about it. There is no doubt about it. But by the same token, India has more responsibility towards reducing environmental pollution than, say, the least developed countries in Africa. Right?
Yes, sir. But so, sir, how should India prioritize? Like, should industrialization be its top priority, or should it be preserving nature?
That is the most fundamental question. And you may like to follow the discussions that are going on right now before the COP26 meeting in Glasgow in England, where they are trying to look into this issue very carefully. And what I would suggest, you can do two things. You can create a Twitter handle in the name of your group, which will be followed by all in your group, and share that Twitter handle with me. My Twitter handle is, I'll share that with you. You can get it from the Twitter as well. Then I can pass on the several discussions, several issues that are being raised and discussed in the context of bringing about the integration between society and ecology. Right, Siddharth?
Yes, sir.
Would anyone like to take the lead in developing a Twitter handle and pass it on to me? Who would do that? Twitter handle for BA Economics 2021. Can someone create it? Siddharth, can you create it?
Sir, I have completely sworn off all social media. So.
Okay, who can? No one. So we are talking about technology, but
sir, can you do that? Yeah, I do not use Twitter, but
I can install
it. But if you want to study economics, now it is high time that you get linked up and hooked up to Twitter.
Yeah, sure.
Rather than to Facebook.
I'll install it today itself and
create. And you develop a link and share it with me. I'll feed you with tweets every day. I promise. Relevant tweets.
Thank you, sir. Okay. Should I email it to you?
Yeah, you can email me the Twitter handle and then I'll share it with you. Right.
All right.
You know my email ID.
Sir, I had a question.
Yes, Saloni, carry on.
Like Siddharth said, and he very rightly said that developed countries are the ones who are most industrialized. But as you also answered, Ananya, that we need to change the definition of education, do you think we should also, it's high time that we also change the definition of equating development with industrialization? Because we have seen that London was the most, at its most populated, not when it was industrializing.
Right. So there is an index brought out by Yale University. You may like to have a look at that index called Sustainable Development Index. And the third country with the highest index, I forgot the name now, is one of the least developed countries. And USA perhaps stands at 36. Right, Saloni?
Yes, sir.
So you may like to have a look at that ranking. Of course, India is much, much below that because of several reasons. But the point is that if you follow the ranking in terms of sustainable development or sustainability, you will find that many of the industrialized countries are at a much lower level than many of the so-called less developed or least developed or underdeveloped countries. So the understanding of economics will also have to undergo changes. It will take some time. It cannot be done overnight, but the process has started. And I just wanted you to give a clue to these sort of discussions. And if you are in touch with me through Twitter, I can supply you with tweets which are relevant. But simultaneously, I would also expect that whatever such news you come across, such tweets and news, you tweet that to me as well. Right? Saloni?
Yes, sir.
Any other question or any other points? I think there is no more. You are already tired and exhausted.
Sir, do you know when we are getting, when we will know which books to buy and all that?
Pardon?
Do you know when we will know which books to buy? Textbook.
We are vulnerable. No doubt of it.
Oh.
I could not get your question because on my side, the technology is not that good. So, can you repeat the question once again?
Sir, when will we get to know which books to buy? Textbooks.
Can you write it out? Because it is somehow. Can you write it on the chat box?
Yes.
Have you started? So the point is, you'll be perhaps happy to know that this semester I am not going to teach any course with you, number one. Number two, you will be having about 5 or 6 or 7 courses this semester, and you will be provided with some course manual as to what are the objectives, what are the different components and contents of the curriculum, and that will also give you the list of references, which you can, some of them are compulsory readings, some textbooks, and some of them are maybe will be some reference books or some papers. The reference books and papers will be available from the library. And if you want, you can buy some textbooks.
Oh, okay, sir. Thanks.
Okay. And this will vary from faculty to faculty. Right, Siddharth?
Okay, sir. Thanks.
Where are you from? Where are you located?
Sir, in Gurgaon, sir.
Gurgaon. Uh-huh. Okay, then. Bye-bye.
Thank you, sir. Goodbye.
Thank you for your sharing.
Good afternoon.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Bye-bye.
Thank you, sir.
Bye-bye.
Thank you, sir.